Let's talk about discrete dynamical systems. So we'll go through an example of the predator-prey model. So this is based on exercise 5.6.5 of the textbook. You can read the description there. The spotted owls are basically going to eat flying squirrels. So let O sub k be the number of spotted owls at time k, where k is measured in months, and S sub k is going to be the number of flying squirrels measured in thousands at time k. And suppose that you know that the number of owls at time k plus 1 is 0.4 times the number of owls at time k plus 0.3 times the number of squirrels in thousands at time k. And similarly, the number of squirrels at time k plus 1 is negative 0.5 times the number of owls plus 1.2 times the number of squirrels. Right? So let's first give some interpretations of what these linear relationships are saying. The 0.4 times ok in the first equation, what that's saying is that if there were no squirrels, so if sk was 0, then only 40% of the owls would survive to the next month. Right? So 0.4 times ok. The 1.2 times sk in the second equation here says that if there were no owls, so if ok was 0, if there were no owls as predators, then the squirrel population would just increase by a factor of 1.2. So that's a 20% increase every month. The 0.3 times sk in the first equation says that every 10,000 squirrels can support an additional owl. There'll be an additional owl that can survive. And the negative 0.5 ok in the second equation, this is saying that every 2 owls, right, would be eating 1,000 squirrels each month. So negative 0.5 times the number of owls is contributing to the squirrel population. So let's set up our discrete dynamical system. Let x sub k be this vector ok sk. Then x sub k plus 1 is a times x sub k, where this matrix A has 0.4 in the top left entry, 0.3 in the top right entry, negative 0.5 in the bottom left, and 1.2 in the bottom right. And so now if we're going to study this dynamical system, we need to study this matrix A. And so we turn to eigenvalues and eigenvectors. And so we want to first find the eigenvalues of this matrix. And so we've got to compute its characteristic polynomial. So that's the determinant of A minus lambda I. I compute the determinant and multiply everything out. Get this quadratic polynomial in lambda. And I'm interested in finding the roots of that polynomial. And so I can factor it either by inspection or by using the quadratic formula. And I see it factors as lambda minus 0.7 times lambda minus 0.9, which tells me the eigenvalues of A are 0.7 and 0.9. So I have these eigenvalues of 0.7 and 0.9. What does this tell me about the dynamical system? Well, one of the things I notice is that both of the eigenvalues are less than 1 in magnitude, less than 1 in absolute value. So that tells me the origin is an attractor, right? So things are attracted towards the origin. If I would have had one eigenvalue bigger than 1 in magnitude and the other one smaller than 1, I would have a saddle point. If I had both eigenvalues bigger than 1 in magnitude, I would have a repeller. And so let's next compute the eigenvectors. So for the eigenvalue 0.7, I've got to solve a minus 0.7 times the identity times x equals the 0 vector. I set up my augmented matrix and row reduce. I see my pivot there, which tells me x2 is a non-pivot column, corresponding to a non-pivot column, so it's free. and x1 is expressible in terms of the free parameter t. And so I see that in parametric vector form, x is t times 1, 1. So I have this eigenvector 1, 1. For the eigenvalue 0.9, I'm solving a minus 0.9 times the identity all times x equals the 0 vector. Again, I set up the augmented matrix and row reduce to solve. I find my pivot here, which tells me x2 is free, so I'll call it t, some free parameter, and x1 is 3/5 t. So in parametric vector form, x is t times 3/5 1. And then I have my eigenvector. So here, I'm allowed to choose any vector, any non-zero vector in this space. I'm going to prefer to deal with, say, an integer vector with integer entries. And so I'm going to just choose t to be 5, and I compute. And then I have this vector 3, 5. And so to summarize, I have eigenvalue 0.7 with corresponding eigenvector 1, 1. I have eigenvalue 0.9 with corresponding eigenvector 3, 5. So the direction of greatest attraction, this is going to be the line through the origin and the vector 1, 1. And I can see that because 0.7 is the smaller eigenvalue in magnitude, in absolute value, and it's attraction because that value is smaller than 1. There's no direction of greatest repulsion because both of the eigenvalues are less than 1 in magnitude. So the origin is an attractor, and so there's no direction of greatest repulsion. Right, so here's my eigenvectors and eigenvectors I've drawn here in blue and red, and the eigenvalues being less than 1 means things flow towards the origin. So if I had some initial condition, x naught, I can express it as a linear combination of v1 and v2, because v1 and v2, the eigenvectors, form a basis for R2, which means any initial condition, x naught, can be written as c1 times v1 plus c2 times v2. But then this tells me that x sub k is c1 times 0.7 to the k times v1 plus c2 times 0.9 to the k v2. And so let me just draw in the conditions on C1 and C2 that correspond to these regions. So I have the eigenvectors drawn in here again in blue and red. So this top region, top wedge, has C1 less than or equal to 0. The middle and the bottom one have C1 bigger than or equal to 0. The bottom region has C2 less than or equal to 0, and the top two regions have C2 bigger than or equal to 0. And so when I'm looking at how this thing flows in this region, everything is getting pulled towards the origin. As K gets large, it's going to look more and more like V2, because 0.9 to the K is going to be bigger than 0.7 to the K. And so these paths are sort of curving slightly to be more like V2 as they approach the origin. In this region where C1 is less than or equal to 0 and C2 is greater than or equal to 0, when the value of C2 is really, really large and the value of C1 is really, really small in magnitude, right, there might be a little portion where the path actually goes, increases in terms of owls and squirrels for a little while before it gets pulled down, because these exponentials have base, 0.7 and 0.9, are smaller than 1. Right? And so a similar argument tells you that in this region where C1 is bigger than or equal to 0 and C2 is bigger than or equal to 0, you also get pulled towards the origin. There might be a slight increase in squirrels and owls based on these coefficients, but eventually 0.7 to the k and 0.9 to the k are going to shrink fast enough that you get pulled to the origin. And so this is bad news for our owls and squirrels, it tells us no matter what the initial condition is, right? The initial condition is going to correspond to some point in this first quadrant. No matter what the initial population is, eventually the squirrels and the owls are going to die out.